What are the three main types of camera stabilization? Is the RS3 Mini the perfect choice for you? Let's find out. Welcome to David Does. Today we're taking a look at the DJI RS3 Mini gimbal. As of late, I've been getting into a lot of photography gear reviews as well as travel gear reviews. It makes sense. Summer's coming about, we're all getting outside, so I'm excited to keep continuing to make that content. Make sure you're subscribed if you aren't. Before we actually dive into the DJI RS3 Mini, I'm gonna go over some principles of image stabilization. This could be thought of as a crash course into video and image stabilization. If you're not familiar with it, it's definitely worth the watch. The second part of this video is actually gonna be me reviewing and taking a look at the DJI RS3 Mini. You definitely wanna stick around for that if you own that gimbal or you're thinking of picking one up, because I have a tip for you that I haven't seen on any other video. It's a tip that actually comes from a different industry that I think is really gonna help if you do happen to use that. The RS3 Mini actually falls into the first category, mechanical stabilization. There are two subcategories within mechanical stabilization we're going to talk about, active and passive stabilization. Active uses electronics such as motors and sensors to ensure that the camera is operating very smoothly. Passive normally uses something like gravity or weights to make sure this happens. Active stabilization are things like gimbals. We all know what these are, where passive are kind of becoming a thing of the past. You can buy these normally pretty inexpensively in Amazon. The first one we're going to talk about is this one where you mount the camera up top and down below you have it weighted, and you essentially are using this big pendulum to make sure that the camera is stabilized.
Steadicams are another perfect example of passive stabilization. These use very similar principles such as gravity and mechanical stabilizers such as shocks to absorb some of the input that our body gives to the camera to smooth out the shot we're trying to make. These aren't going anywhere, they're still used quite a bit in the movie and television industry, as a lot of these cameras they're normally carrying around are incredibly heavy, and these allow you to transfer that weight from your hands to your body.
The second category is optical stabilization. Again, just like mechanical, this one has two subcategories. The first is stabilization in the lens, and the second is stabilization in the camera. Your camera lens actually has a lot of lens groups inside of it. Most of them do. If you have a stabilized lens, there's likely a stabilizing lens group on the inside. The first photo you see here is a perfectly steady shot. Light enters the front of the camera and goes directly back to the sensor. In the second one, you can see that the stabilizing lens group is actually skewed just a little bit to counteract some of the vibration that the camera is experiencing. This is a really nice type of camera stabilization. However, these lenses normally cost a little bit more money. The second category of optical stabilization happens in camera. This is really simple. A lot of new cameras on the market are coming with this. Essentially, the sensor is motorized and it is moving up and down, left and right to counteract any unwanted movement. This does eat the battery up though. You are basically powering these motors constantly to figure out what is going to be the most effective way to stabilize your camera. Third is digital stabilization. This can either happen on the camera itself or in post. My B camera here, the GoPro Hero 11, does it on board. It's what makes this camera so nice for athletes and folks who do adventure sport. There's very minimal editing after you're done with using this camera. Even if you're taking this thing down a mountain while you're skiing or on a bike ride, that's really nice. If your camera doesn't have any type of stabilization, you can use digital stabilization in post. Editors like DaVinci have this, and how this works is actually how the camera works itself. Is it has this frame it's looking at, and it zooms in on it, and then it uses some fancy algorithms to figure out where it has to crop to make sure that that image you're looking at frame by frame is stabilized. It's quite ingenious. In most of the film editing tools you use, this is actually quite easy. So with those three types of stabilization in mind, you don't have to use just one. You kind of got to figure out what is best for you. We're going to jump into the RS3 Mini. The big reason I got this was, like I said, spring and summer's here. I'm starting to record a lot of my video intros and as much as possible actually outside. I don't want to just be sitting in the studio all the time. I also wanted to find something that would allow me to videotape myself. I don't have a whole team of people here videotaping me. So the option was either figure out a really hefty selfie stick for my A7IV or go with something like a gimbal. I really think I made a good choice with this gimbal. Let's jump right into it. All right, so I actually already have my Sony mounted up on my RS3 Mini. There are many videos online on how to do the calibration. I'm not gonna go through that now. Check those out. I'm putting my favorite down below. There are a few accessories that come with this. Number one, there is a set of legs that really help you dial this in whenever you're getting it calibrated. Also, just so you can sit down and not have to carry it around, it does get quite heavy. It can also do portrait orientation. I really like this whenever I'm shooting TikToks with this camera. I just can flip this over. You do have to rebalance it after you do that, but that's a small price to pay. It also fits really well in my sturdy small rig tripod, filming that in the studio. Right off the bat, my favorite feature of this, and one of the reasons why I went with the RS3 Mini, is to actually use it kind of as a selfie stick. If you hit this button down here 3 times, it goes into selfie mode. It swings around and you can actually see it. And if I want to go ahead and go back to my point of view, I can just double tap and it swings around. There are a few different types of follow modes. The first is pan follow, meaning this camera is only going to move whenever I pan across. You can see it's following my finger here. If I do this or this, it's actually staying stable. It's really nice for doing shots like this if you're going to be walking on top of the camera. The other is pan tilt follow. So this means if you have pan tilt follow set up, it's going to do the same thing. It's going to follow the camera. But let's say there's something on the ground that's interesting. It's actually gonna point the camera down at the ground. That's really nice. There are actually quite a few other modes in here. It's kind of fun is the 360 roll, where the camera is actually gonna go like this, and you can use your rolling feature to make it do a very cool type of shot. And here's my tip that I was saving for last that I've got from another industry that works incredibly well. If you ever worked with something that requires you to tighten a nut or a bolt down to a certain torque and you need to see that and verify every once in a while that it hasn't slipped, you normally do markings on the actual bolt to make sure it doesn't move around. Rifles also do this on their optics if you want to have a co-witness mark so you know that your rifle optic is always in spec. What I'm using it here for is actually I'm just putting a dot on all the different axes that I need to calibrate. So whenever I take this camera off and I put it back on, I can get that pretty darn close because in its travel mode, this gimbal actually compacts down really far, but you have to kind of undo all your work for calibrating it. Overall, I really like this. If you're looking for a small gimbal for a fairly big camera, the RS3 Mini may be the one for you. I'm a brand new YouTube channel, so if you have any questions about this, let me know. I may be able to find another camera and test it out if you're unsure, maybe do a little bit of research and comment back. Thanks for watching. David Does.